to increase women's participation in public policy and political leadership, unquote. I have not only empathy, but also full solidarity for your mission. Women hold half the sky, so why should not they hold at least one-third of the political ground? The insignificant number of women in parliament and state legislatures has robbed these august houses of their representative character. Unfortunately, the cause of political empowerment of women has so far received support more in words than in action. Party, the Bharatiya Janata Party, and our allies in the ruling coalition have less to blame in this regard. You are aware that two of our alliance parties, the AIADMK and the Trinamool Congress, are headed by women leaders. Both Dr. Jayalalitha and Sushri Mamata Banerjee are leaders with exceptional mass appeal. Today, they are playing an important role in national politics. The BJP was the first party to formally adopt at its national executive meeting in Vadodara way back in 1987, a resolution seeking 33% reservation for women in parliament and state legislatures. Since then, we have consistently championed the cause both in and outside the elected houses in Delhi and in the state capitals. Speaking of internal democracy, our party's constitution mandates that at least one of the five general secretaries has to be a woman. Our party also has proportionately the largest number of women MPs in the Lok Sabha. I must, however, admit that the level of participation of women in decision-making and in the party's activities at various levels is still well below my satisfaction. In the BJP too, as in all other parties, the Mahila Morcha is one of the peripheral organizations and not integral to shaping the policies and programs of the party. Unfortunately, some political parties are holding up its passage for reasons that are totally unrelated to the purpose for which this law for affirmative action is intended. Worse still, the manner in which even a debate on the subject was stalled in the Lok Sabha marked one of the lowest points in India's parliamentary democracy. Women of all classes and castes are victims of discrimination and deprivation. Hence, the proposed Women's Reservation Bill is intended to empower all women. Raising the issue of sub-quotas at this stage dilutes the emphasis on gender justice. The message of this historic legislation at the earliest, what is at stake is the very credibility of the entire political establishment and frequently stated commitment to political reservation for women. They should well think that men in general have no real interest in economic democracy as well. Political democracy cannot last unless there lies at the base social and economic democracy, unquote. This, in my view, is the kernel of the concept of social justice. Unfortunately, social justice has been narrowly projected in recent years. It focuses only on issues of caste, excluding issues of gender justice. I am convinced that in the long run, women's empowerment will positively transform the social and political agenda around the world. I conclude and congratulate the Women's Political Watch for organizing this seminar. Thank you.